a short story that I'll read that will be in English. The initial impression, a dating article says, is the most important. Brush your teeth, iron your shirt, shine your shoes before your first date. During the encounter, look at her posture. Is she showing her armpits to you? It indicates that she wants to be vulnerable. She wants to submit. Don't forget to look at her lips. That she is ready to shorten the distance. Follow the 3 dates rule and at the 3rd meeting leap and kiss her, disarming with passion. Who have sex? However, keep in mind that there is no correlation between the number of dates, between the first sex and the number of months or years the two will stay together. In a crumpled cranberry baby doll t-shirt, bites her upper lip, fingers a glossy device, scrolls and glides on the smooth and spacious CityLink bus. So different from the one from Blanchard's Star, that one sped up, freed itself from any restraints, and the tree branches slapped its hard face, screeching, scraping, tumbling across its roof, causing as much damage as possible. Like a jilted lover, just like Bashir. This one is a smooth operator that glides towards gold, toward its gulls and cladach. Larissa touches her palate, strokes its screen with an email. I'll take you to the prom in Salt Hill. Would you fancy a swim? We'll dip our feet in the water, but you have to mind the jellyfish. The last time I splashed near the shore, a jellyfish bit me. Two young women stopped to help me and inspected the bite, inviting me to their caravan to sprinkle some vinegar, like I am a dish. I'll show you the bite once we meet. There is still a mark on my thigh, and we can slow dance. Since you wrote, it was your dream to slow dance with a woman. Marisa's white shirt is folded compactly, silk petals of sleeves on its chest. Her graphite pants, packed in a guitar case, are straight and narrow, like a schoolgirl's pencils. She plans to dress half an hour before the bus arrives. She gets up from her seat, shoehorns herself into the tiny toilet, squeezing out some toothpaste. With cedar perfume from L'Occitane, she removes the weariness of the long bus ride and the long list of past disappointments. She's traveling distances to meet her match and to melt. Her date wrote to her, I keep my body in good shape. I met a fit class at 7, fit boxing at 9, Zumba at 5 in the evening. And Larissa experiences a tingling sensation thinking of bodies. The common words of the email sound foreign, uttered by a person with a special, far-sighted vision. A newcomer from a faraway land. The land with gold and sand, with massive minarets and mint tea, with women ripened for love, who used to cover their denim dreams under a drab. The bus glides towards Galway, past the pastures, past Larissa's past with paternalistic Bashir, for whom their union was mostly a social function, to her new future, the future of feelings, and a belief that something bigger will take place in Galway. She felt suddenly the hunger of the land she lived in, the need chosen by many people to be loved. Echoing the words of a Balinese law writer once famous, but who then disappeared into a rainy oblivion of gypsy shacks and postcards from the former Soviet bloc. His pages open up, spread themselves on both sides of the bus. Larissa reads Ireland as an open book, a known text on green rectangular signs, unfamiliar sheep grazing grass. Gliding to Galway, Larissa folds and unfolds a small piece of paper, her miniature wings. On it, help me. She touches the paper words with her eager lips. If I find love in Ireland, I will not come back to Bashir. Larissa's intense face, with immensely huge eyes and razor-cut hair, contrasts with the yellow square of paper with naive, round handwriting. Bashir is Larissa's estranged husband from Syria. His grocery store in Gothenburg is called Red October. Pieces of feta in fetal positions swim in voluminous plastic trays. A cheerful cashier with sleek black hair once showed them an Instagram picture from a San Fran deli with the tag Lesbian Feta, made on the Greek island of Lesbos. The best feta we've ever had. Eat it tonight. Bashir's stony face immediately changed. He didn't find it all funny. Talcum dust on his cans of tahini. Nuts priced like gold. Shelves looking like a war-torn warehouse. Olives in ribbed cans with metal edges, reminiscent of military ammunition. Walls the color of cement, Bashir's clothes the color of khaki. Habibi were Bashir's words when Larissa would step in. He'd say Habibi and fish some feta out of a plastic tray for customer. When they fished a stillborn out of Larissa, Bashir was tending to sage tea capsules, to third world okra, to vine leaves sealed in round coffins of metal, not to her. Larissa simply collected some things and left, hearing the call of the wild, the call of a recruiter from Google in Dublin. The bus dips its nose into a depot. Larissa is already fresh and fragrant, with petal sleeves, with blooming lips, her heart watered by desire. A woman with hair the color color of copper, waits for her outside. The woman has a devilish green and Middle Eastern eyes, like two soft, dark Iranian dates. Her hair stands up like a coil, like springy antennas. What cuisine do you fancy? We could pick up food and prepare something at home. Larissa imagines how the sun licks their plates. A well-lit room, the abundance of palatal pleasures, the ease of pairing the drinks with the first and second courses, the pairing, the matching, the melting, the coupling. Good wine, a good olive oil, making the beginning of the relationship smooth. Would you prefer vanilla or kofta? Nila asks, and Larissa's limbs fill up with warmth. She eats that Middle Eastern bread that lies on its back in the oven, breathing through all her pores, opening up, but the promise of a slow dance makes her legs tremble. As they walk through the market, they pick basil, garlic, and carrots, a tricolor of gold. Larissa's eyes follow Nila's painted lips. The letter catches her. Larissa asks Lebanese-born Nila to say something in her own language. Whatever you say is so sensual. Yes, Arabic is me. Larissa stands at the kitchen counter. Nila is undressing courgettes from their cellophane gowns. Larissa asks her about her past. Where does she come from? Where she's going, if she favors affairs or a long-term relationship. Is she interdependent or codependent? Would she like to merge or be self-sufficient? She poses questions from the online dating advice. I was the man of the house, Nila says, and touches her lip with her little finger, then touches basil. Lips and basil stir a craving in her. There was the Lebanon War. Do you know about the war? I've no idea, Larissa stiffens. She forbids herself to mention Bashir, whose uncles participated in this war on the opposite side, or the invisible divide between her and her estranged husband, even before the stillbirth. Her marital status should not affect the slow dance. Help me! She silently addresses somebody above the ceiling. The yellow paper unfolds its wings. The words are written into the wind. I came to Ireland to love and be loved. Nila continues. I grew up during the war. When the bombs started falling, I gathered my younger siblings and we all ran to a bomb shelter. Larissa minimizes Bashir in her mind, changes him into a black dot. His strong fists, like two round turnips, dissolve. She takes a carrot, peels its skin, unveiling its orangey texture and a springy demeanor. When Larissa is smoothing the carrot with her finger, removing the cuticles of brownish skin, she senses Nila's nipples perk up under her orange dress. Nila says, I grew up during the war. One day, we went to cinema. It was totally empty. A projectionist asked, you really want to watch a movie? Don't you hear the bombs? And we answered, yes, we do. But we are tired of hiding and running away. We want to live. She'll take the guitar from its case and sing beside the show.
The story.
When we lived on Mount Lebanon, our house was between two fighting forces. On the right, there were Syrians, and on the left, Israelis. We had to leave abruptly to save ourselves. My mom hid a pistol in a baby carriage to protect us, and with some belongings, we sped down a hill. Sleeping, sliding stealthily down, down, driven by the need to escape. Suddenly, Larissa sees Nila naked, wrapped only in words. More and more see-through words. She grasps baby carriage, summer dress, narrow bridge, but they are translucent as dragonfly's wings and leave no trace on her fingers. Nila's childhood, hopes, past, torso are very warm. Gathering courage, Larissa descends a grassy hill. A candlelight smoothens the hair. It reminds her of golden fur, Mons Pubis, a fuzzy compound, the gore and the glory of Mount Lebanon. On the right, there are Syrians. On the left, Israelis. Between the folds, inside is pristinely white flesh. A sculptured peak of pale wax, thick, tender petals. The tongue glides over them, travels through corals, performs a curly dance. It goes up and then down. Down and then slowly up. While we are descending the mountain, while we are running away, on the right, there are Israelis, death and destruction. On the left, there are Syrian militants with their rifles. And in the middle, in the dark and deep well between the folds, there is a pulsing sculptured peak. The war and the bombs. Nila's voice reaches out. Her body is convulsing. She screams. When the bombs fall into the sea stays impeccably beautiful. Calm. The leaves, the corals, the pearly white petals. The soldiers chase civilians. The salty sand sticks to heavy armor and sweaty skin. The bombs drop here and there, but we want to live. Ars Interpres published.
The shortest piece.
Yes, we'll just read some parts of it.
Just want to explain, the last piece is a short of a miniature by Hans Eisler. We work closely with Brecht, and this was, it's called Panzerschlacht. So, it means tank warfare.
Had passed, you were already conceived when I learned that your great-grandfather had a grave form of cancer. At 95, in a hospital bed, he was calling his Yiddish mamele, who had a wise look, a light complexion, and the last name of Whiteman, the one who luckily perished from illness in Belarusia before the Nazis came to their place. He lived through it all, waking up to hymns and hypocrisy on the radio, watching care of the prepared crafty parades on TV, walking with fake Fox factory workers, waving Soviet flags. Your great-grandfather lived through all that, and then, following his adventurous, adulterous kids, each with two wives, and live-in right in your face, and secret one on the side, the one for whom business trips were invented, came to the US. In California, his skeptical self embraced capitalism and capitulated to cancer. That's what we assumed. Stubborn and strong as he was, he could not be eradicated by extraneous forces, such as famine or fascists during World War II, or a freak accident later, when at 90, on a cold, rainy night, with a backpack on his shoulders, he was hit by a bus. With his outward strength toward the world, he could only be destroyed little movement or quickening, a manifestation of a quickly growing organism. And the fatal moment, the agony, disintegration. That's, I foolishly thought, how life is. And those butterflies. Your Italian father learned a new expression from me. Butterflies in the stomach. A fragile feeling we both felt when we first met. He strolled around an abandoned gas station with me, very serious in his suit, which, as I discovered later, he wore only a few times, favoring t-shirts of his beloved rock bands, and carried in his hand a cup with steamy espresso from a coffee house where we planted our blind date. The editor suggests plant, but I'm talking about planting a seed of the date that in 1 month sprouted marriage. The cup was his protection, something to cling to clutch in his hand, to get a hold of what was awaiting to happen. If we were in the 19th century, which he, in history buff, dug, quoting the luminaries of the time with the same ease and elation as modern mammoths of history monographs, he probably would be tightening his grip on a rapier. He was a large, 39-year-old man, strikingly athletic and sturdy, with a Wild West streak, sending him successfully to all six continents, but weak in his heart, which started accelerating, legs walking slow and giving way when he saw me. With his full, yet not flabby calves and pronounced, disproportionately large head, he reminded me of a gigantic infant. Yes, he looked like a baby. And when a would-be baby in a womb moves, the sensation its mother experiences is sometimes referred to as butterflies in the stomach. It's those tender taps of a thin, yet stiff butterfly's wing against a womb's soft walls. No wonder the story begins with a calculation. There is an arithmetic to life. At 11 gestational weeks, you were around 3 inches. At 17, 6, but the quickening was supposed to start, according to a pregnancy book, when you scored 18, 19. Orchestrated by two skipped heartbeats, I came to stand still, sensing something unusual. To believe that something once non-existent and silent is finally revealing itself. Sitting late at night in front of a blue crystal screen, I place my right hand on the crown of the world's head, on the plastic back of my warm, amenable mouse, switching languages and shuffling events, playing with a necklace of internet links, jumping from recovered paintings looted by the Nazis to Nabokov's Berlin in the 20s, and from a Sumatra disaster to South America's currency gains. My left hand is on top of my belly, detecting movements that just weeks ago were absent. But you had already lived in my womb for several full months. For those months, nobody heard you as you held your umbilical breath. You were like a planet that, as everybody knows, exists, but no one has ever been there. How, out of nothing, did something come? Or, as your Italian father's Gibbana teacher would say in her brazenly broken English, how out of nothingness came this mind-blowing somethingness? The world looks distant and disengaged. Its sultry surface facing me seems to be uneventful. News reports invariably have to do with somebody else. In my life, everything's natural. Even a big dog of danger is neutered. Nothing is new. But now, I'm made aware that something seemingly absent for more than 4 months, no quickening, no quirky karate kicks, had actually hidden itself. And before the time struck, did not indicate its portentous presence. Could it be that what we consider the lack of miraculousness just hesitates to make itself evident? In California, in the evenings after my comfy computer petrification at a 9-to-5 high-tech firm, I wasn't used to lifting my head up. Those few basic aluminium-colored stars hiding behind our domestic negligent smog failed to capture my interest. But in Hawaii, happily pregnant and unemployed, I ascended Mauna Kea and deposited into the freezing darkness with a cup of free tea from the Gemini Observatory. Wrapped in a warm cocoon of fleece clothes under a sclerotic sky, covered with a silver web of capillaries. Multitudes and multitudes of unreachable planets realized that there are many invisible things.
Snow drift and take
giving away your bread coupons. Without your 100 grams, several breadcrumbs, you would die. Your great-grandmother was evacuated through the road of life, also known as the road of death, since wagons with provisions and people were relentlessly bombed. But when the war ended, she, who played romances on the guitar, experienced hunger. My 1-year-old father was evacuated in the beginning of the war from Belarus. His relatives who remained there, who had neither the guts nor great premonitions to leave, were led to the edge of a trench. My father's great-grandfather, named Naftalan, a 94-year-old Jewish grave digger by training, was among them, and protectively flanked on both sides by daughters and grandsons, probably did not care why those graves were not properly made. In seconds, all of them were dead and covered up by the earth. When my father grew up, all he talked about during family reunions was hunger and food. How in exile in Novosibirsk, during those cold, bare years of war, they had a hen named Katya and a pig named Boria, and how poor Katya and Boria had to be eaten. When I visit my parents' apartment, which looks like a resourcefully stocked grocery store, I stumble upon cans and canisters on the floor. I flounder counting dollar store food containers. Carrots and nuts, goat's milk, garlic, meticulously washed blueberries in plastic jars that I have to bring back after consuming this deliriously desperate feast for them to replenish. And they are replenished themselves by knowing that they can play a part. It's as if a fishing bob suddenly dives, and something inside me, the bait perhaps, is instantly swallowed by a persistent, strong fish. It's as if a frog tries to surface, pounding with its limp, little legs while gurgling and reaching the top of the pond to gasp some fresh air. It's as if one takes a polished chestnut speckled with sunlight. One of those that are infinitely being carried in the pocket in hopes for finite luck, and shakes it, hearing how something inside it knocks and rolls, shyly and gently. Everything goes into boisterous, boiling pan of word witchery, simmering waters rambling under the sun, crawling crickets touching things with their cautious mustache. A round, firm's bee's nest pulsing under an open palm. One can evoke the whole animal world with its cryptic nature and creatures to describe what is going on pictures, only a new baby busily moving inside me. At night, I cannot sleep. In those popular preparatory books, they say that when a mother is awake, her fetus is usually dozing. When a mother is sound asleep, the unsupervised fetus starts to hiccup and kick. Not true with us. We are in sync. You are restlessly swimming and almost knocking me over, water splashing in the room. I am reckless, letting myself rock on the nightly insomnia waves. Prior to your conception, I segregated my dark self from the world. Days passed in frustration, procrastination, contemplation, or writing. Single-handedly, I faced the dreaded duality of the day, when routine would overcome death. Have you ever watched how a mother and daughter, arms around each other's shoulders or waists, go to another room to confide secret tales? They need that seclusion, they unite to discuss. Only several months pregnant, I am alone, but inside me there is one more me, and it adds a different quality to my solitude. Waking up, worrying. Where are those wiggly movements and wobbly karate kicks? Living as a schizophrenic, as it is perfectly normal to sense in your whole somebody, somebody else, to paranoically listen to voices, to panic when not hearing gurgling or tapping. It's all in reverse. A mental patient is considered healed when they finally convince him that he's alone, when he is not guided by legitimate ghosts, when he becomes so incensed and thick-skinned that he ceases paying attention to voices, or stops believing in little people inside his stomach or head. On the contrary, many lend a sympathetic ear to a woman who claimed that she heard her child's voice, who was still pregnant. Imagine him grown up, coloring her mildly gray, monotonous middle age. A man, hearing voices, suspects that he's becoming insane, sensing a separate life inside her. A woman is jubilant. And in this case, it's not a phantom, it's a fetus. Спасибо большое.